Welcome to this service today. As I share this message with you, it would have been preached in the sanctuary here at Woodlawn in the 11 a.m. worship service on Sunday. But we welcome all of you who are worshiping with us, who are part of our online community of worshipers. We pray that all is well with you, and we want to remind each one of you that you are an essential part of the body of Christ here at Woodlawn. I'm continuing this series of messages today entitled The Art of Spiritual Formation, and we are focusing today on the essence of true community.
Everlasting.
I read now from the Acts of the Apostles, the second chapter, beginning with the 42nd verse, these words. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. All came upon everyone, because many wonders and signs were being done by the apostles. All who believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and goods and distribute the proceeds to all, as any had need. Day by day, as they spent much time together in the temple, they broke bread at home and ate their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having the goodwill of all the people. And day by day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. This is the word of life. Thanks be to God. Through the gift of the Holy Spirit, and the beginning of what it means to be the church as the body of Christ. We read in the 41st verse, so those who were welcoming the message of Peter were baptized, and that day about 3,000 persons were added. What a glorious record this is, as it gives us the picture of the early church. But we are focusing today on those scriptures that begin with the 42nd verse that define the nature and the essence of true community. First of all, I like the image of community for the church. Increasingly, we have churches that are using that model. Centenary Church in Macon, a historic congregation there, is now referred to as the Centenary Community. The Centenary United Methodist Church has deep roots in the city of Macon, and you will find its campus is located adjacent to Mercer University. Well, what is it that defines a true community? We read here in the 42nd chapter that those who continued as they had been baptized continued steadfastly in the apostles' teaching. Now, each time we gather, we lift up a creedal statement of the church. The most well-known and beloved of all the creeds, of course, is the Apostles' Creed, which is a part of this service today. In that creed, we have the essence of the teachings of the apostles. We also know that in the first century, there evolved a body of teachings known as the Didache. Didache in Greek means the teaching. And in the body of those teachings, which comprised the Didache, were instructions about how the community was to worship and how they were to form themselves, as well as the ethics of the community and the issues of how the community was to be led. So when we read that these early Christians continued steadfastly in the apostles' teaching, What we are needing to understand is that they were, through the direction and leadership of the 12 apostles, being guided in conjunction with the teachings of Jesus Christ. And the community was to be shaped by those teachings. Then we go on to read that they continued steadfastly in fellowship. The Greek word here is koinonia. You may very well have heard of the Koinonia Farm in America's Georgia. The early roots of that community were in its founding by Clarence Jordan. And you may know about the Cotton Patch Gospel, the teachings that are a part of that series of books that Clarence put together are the roots of what later became a very famous musical referred to as the Cotton Patch Gospel. The roots of that Koinonia community were in the issues of living out these teachings of the apostles and doing so with a justice-oriented concern. And in its early roots, in 1942, it became an emblem of social justice, and it reflected an attitude toward equality, as well as carrying out these teachings of the apostles, and they shaped themselves according to what we are reading here in the book of Acts. So when we read about fellowship, that concept of koinonia is enhanced in our understanding as we go through each of these verses. For example, the fellowship is reflected in the next aspect of what it meant to be a true community, and that was in the breaking of bread. Now, in the breaking of bread, we want to remember there is the bread that is broken at the Lord's table. So that image of the breaking of bread is very much tied to the sacrament of Holy Communion. As we think about the nature of that sacrament, we remember that that is done as we commune together. Thus the word communion. We are in a very challenging way in this time of social distancing as we have been carrying out our safe practices and celebrating the sacrament in this sanctuary and encouraging persons to do so at home by the delivery of the communion elements that we're sharing with our homebound members. We are very much connected to this concept of how community is being shaped in the breaking of the bread. Now, that breaking of the bread, of course, is also going to be seen a little later in these scriptures as we reflect on them today in relationship to the sharing of their food as they had need of that at table in relationship to mealtime. Then we read that they continued steadfastly in their prayers. We have the example of the Lord's Prayer, which of course is an important part of all of our devotional lives, our spiritual lives, and the worship of the church. It is the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray, and it is often, of course, referred to as the most perfect example of prayer. We know that these prayers of the early Christians would have been very much shaped by that prayer of Jesus that we refer to as the Lord's Prayer. Then in Acts 2:43, we read that fear came upon every soul in the community. Now that word fear is one, of course, that has so many ramifications for us as we begin to think about the nature of who we are in relationship to God. We need to understand that that fear here was not a crippling fear. It was a fear that was an awe of God. Being an awe of God meant that you were respectful of God, and you were also, of course, so fixed in your connection to God that your respect of God opened you up to the presence of God and all of the ways that God was manifesting God's self. And thus we read that many signs and wonders were done through the apostles, through the leaders of the early church, through the leaders of that early church community. And certainly that awe and respect of God is essential to how we worship, but also how we are anticipating the work of God daily in our personal lives and in the world around us. Then we read these verses, which perhaps are the most challenging of all the verses in Acts 2. That all who believe had all things in common. We read here that all believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and goods and distribute the proceeds to all as any had need. Now, in our thinking as persons of this century, we may immediately associate this sharing of all things in common with a form of communism. But I want to remind you here that this was voluntary, that these acts were acts of self-sacrifice on behalf and for the sake of the community, as well as those who were in need outside of the walls, which there were no formal walls of the church because there was no church building, but outside of any sense of boundaries that that community may have had in context of where it was located. So that what they had and they shared in common was not only for the benefit of all who were a part of the community, but also out of what they shared in common were the acts of charity and benevolence and outreach. And in verse 35, we read, they sold their possessions and goods and distributed them all according to as anyone had need. Now if we were to go down to Americus to the Cornelia farm, and I would love to take a group of persons from the Woodlawn congregation down there once we get through this time we are in, and you have the opportunity to have conversation with the people that are there, you will find that there are people who live in that community who carry out this practice of sharing what they have, as we read in the book of Acts. Then in Acts 2, 46 through 47, we read that these early Christians took their food with gladness. Now that's obviously not something that we'll have any problem associating with in the body of Christ and in the church. Methodist people usually do a very good job at taking their food with gladness. And certainly our fellowship is often associated with the sharing of food in the church. We are in this challenging time now where that is not practical and not there are safety issues around it. We miss our fellowship time at table with one another on Wednesday nights or Tuesday nights, as you were sharing that time, I know, before I came here, and other occasions when the church would gather and share food. But I want to remind you that this connection was not within a formal church building structure, but we're reading here of they took their food with gladness in the context of their meal times in their homes. So as they were gathering together at table in their homes, there was that sense of the extension of the Lord's table into their own domestic lives. So at the sharing at meal time with family and invited guests, there was that sense that the breaking of bread at that table was echoing the breaking of bread at the Lord's table. And so they took their food with gladness, because they immediately connected in their minds as they partook of food at mealtime. They made that connection between that food and the spiritual food and the body and blood of Jesus Christ. Remember the images that we saw in the film Babette's Feast a few Sundays ago, when Babette, of course, in her generosity, gave it all up so she could prepare this glorious meal, and all of these people from the community came in and were able to share in that experience. And in the images in that film, we could see how those persons were taking that food with gladness.
Then we read that all were praising God, and they had the favor of all people. That sense of the very essence of their community became contagious beyond the confines of the community, so that persons were drawn into the community. And they, we read then in Acts 2:47, the Lord added to the assembly day by day. Now this is the growth of the community. There was that charismatic, magnetic quality and the way they were practicing their faith, so that others were drawn in and wanting to be a part of their community. Walter Brueggemann, the great scholar of the scriptures and one of my mentors, reminds us that as the Lord added to the assembly day by day, it was not because of our contemporary sense of what evangelism is, which is so often and has been so often associated now for decades in the church with marketing and selling your church to the public. But their devotion was to preaching, to fellowship, to worship, and to acts of caring. And because their devotion was to that, their community became a true reflection of what it means to be the body of Christ. And as they devoted themselves to that preaching and fellowship and worship and acts of caring, then of course they began to grow in spirit and to grow in numbers. Now, this is so much a part of my hope for who we are as the people of God, as we grow into the vision of what that may mean for the Woodlawn Church. That we have this sense of devotion to preaching, to worship, to fellowship, and to acts of charity and outreach. And that if we are rooted in preaching, worship, prayer, acts of charity and fellowship, then we will grow as a congregation. I think much of what we're suffering from in the church today is that the contemporary modes of evangelism have grown tired. We are in this very moment being reconfigured as the church in this time of pandemic. There are things about that are very challenging for us and difficult and maybe even hurtful and cause us fear. But at the same time, there is opportunity in that. Opportunity for us to return to the original roots of what it meant to be the church and what the essence of true community is. In this world where churches became so much connected to being driven by entertainment concerns, we've got to bring people in through entertainment. Where local with Messiah and cappuccino with Christ became the driving force of how we thought we would bring people into the church. Now we find ourselves in this time where those concepts cannot be carried out, they cannot be acted upon. As Will Willimon reminds us, as one views modern congregations, many with their hectic rounds of activities, yoga, ceramics, basket weaving, one suspects that socialization had been substituted for the gospel of Jesus Christ. That somehow we thought in warm-hearted busyness we would be empowered by the Spirit. Now, this is where our own time of self-reflection is very important as we consider the essence of true communion.
We must confess that as the body of Christ, as the bride of Christ, we're not wearing white. We are sinners. And in our brokenness, we know and acknowledge today that we need to be healed. We are wounded, and we have wounded others as the body of Christ. So as we come into that concept of the essence of true community, as we return to these roots, as I have outlined them for us, as they are outlined in the book of Acts, I encourage us to be mindful that this is exciting, that the excitement should be contagious as we read these scriptures about how the early church evolved. And we must also understand that as we read in the book of Acts, the early church could not wear white as the bride of Christ. They too were sinners. And yet, we are all here today. We are all invited in the United Methodist Church to the Lord's table. We have an open table. No one is ever turned away from the table of Jesus Christ. We're all reminded today that the good news is that Holy Week is marked with Good Friday, but it doesn't end with Good Friday. The good news is that the cross of Jesus Christ leads us to the place of resurrection and new life. We don't need to be perfect in order for God to work in us. We do not need to have everything together before God begins to move anew in our midst. And I celebrate with you today that the God that we worship is the God that is still working in our midst. And that the church is God's beloved bride. And God is not done working with his beloved bride. But the time has come for us today, for you and for me, to seek and embrace the essence of true community. May it be so. May it be so in me. May it be so in you. May it be so here in Woodlawn. May it be so.
Thank you.